wise, let us discuss a few things about the chapter, two stories about flying. Okay, what are the two stories about flying? One is about, the narrator there talking about his experience, how he wanted, to fly back home. And although it was, a risk that he took, but still he managed to reach his, country safely or his destination, right? First story is about that. Second, it is about, again, about flying, right? And it is about a little bird. And we imagine that these could be the thoughts, these could be the feelings which are there going on in the little bird's mind, and how it is hesitating to spread its wings and to start flying. We think it is something very natural, for birds to fly. They should not be afraid. Just like we as humans, we learn to walk gradually. And of course, there is the little hesitation, the little fear of falling over, little fear of tripping over. That's why we hold our parents' hands. And then, of course, we start walking independently and then we never look back. So similarly for the birds also, right? So both of them here, very, very short stories. But there are things now that we are going to discuss from the examination point of view. So it is very easy to just read the story, understand what the summary is about and what are the contents of the chapter. So I'd like you to open your books here today. I'm not sharing the screen of this chapter, so I want you all to open the books there. If you have the books, let's see if I'm able to share the screen. Yes, students, what is the first story about? What is the first story? I've written it as a mystery. What makes this story a mystery? What makes this story? Yes, so there is here, the narrator talks about his experience, how he was flying from Paris to England. Yes, from France to England. And although he was not really, of course, with a full fuel tank, the seagull will fly, definitely will fly. Nishita, why won't the seagull fly? Of course, yes, it had fears. And in the end, what happens to the seagull? Let me finish this first. Let's not mix the two stories, okay? Let us discuss the first one, right? So the narrator there, he takes off in his plane, he takes the risk. Yeah, it's a festival season, it's a holiday season. He wants to be with his family. Secondly, he's missing the British breakfast. He wants to have that nice breakfast at home. He does take the chance and he starts flying. He just talks about that how everything, the sky was very clear, the moon was there visible, and yes, it was a clear sky. And then the problem really started when all of a sudden those dark clouds, they appeared. And he had to take a very, quick decision. Now, when we are here, like pilots say, it is right how they have to take a decision which affects the lives of so many people, right? When you're on the road also, yeah, when you have to apply your brake and do you have the liberty of crossing that speed or reaching that speed limit? Because you are there not only putting your own lives at risk, you're putting the other people's lives at risk. So where there are times in life when you have to take that split second decision. So what did he decide to do? He did not have fuel much, right? That is there all of it. Yes. And of course, the visibility was also there. The time would be much longer, right? As if he had to fly around the clouds. What did he decide to do? To go through them, right? And what did he see also? What did he come across? So what did he see in the distance? He saw a black aeroplane, right? And it was there throughout, seemed as if it was helping, guiding. And when he landed, he went to the control room, he wanted to, meet the pilot and say a big thank you to him because he had helped him out of all the, what a problem there. But to his surprise, what did the control room people tell him? That there was no such plane, right? And he was the only one on the radar. Now, when we read this story, there are certain things here, okay? Now, what are the things about this story that make it real? What are the things about it? Let us just discuss it. You might get a question to identify facts, right? And you might have to separate the opinions. What are facts? What are facts? Information that is given to you. Statements that you believe in. And on the basis of that information, what do you make? You make your opinions. That is what an opinion is. Yes. Now, on the basis of this, what are the facts here that we have from this chapter? Let's just see. This story here. Yes, we know about the pilot, right? We know about him, you know, like about his flight. We know about the problem that he had, about the issues here, about the cloud, and of course, the fuel. These are the things that we have, right? We also have mentioned that there was an aeroplane, right? Okay. Dakota, that is the kind of plane that he was flying, right? It was a Dakota that he was flying, right? So, of course, here, facts here, of course, you want to know the where he was going, right? Paris or London, right? Whenever, these are the things that are given. It's also given that aeroplane was there. The lights were on and it seemed as if you could see the pilot also there. Isn't it? All this is given. Then we also have a very important information in the end that he was not visible on the radar. He was not within the range of that. Right? That means what? What was then? What was that plane? What was the black aeroplane? Was it something supernatural? Was it, yes, an illusion? Very good. Was it his imagination? Or sometimes, yes, but, you know, like, what is there? Because we have only the pilot's viewpoint, right? We don't have someone justifying that. We don't have another person agreeing to this statement, right? So we have to really divide fact from fiction. Okay. So what could be that, you know, that aeroplane, was it really there? Or is it that, you know, when we are really in times of distress, when we are going through troubled times, and what happens is that we somehow get that strength to fight that problem. We get that courage to overcome that crisis, to go through it. Do you think that was, you know, like maybe, yes, as you said, it was an illusion. So what is an illusion? Something that appears to be, right? Yes. So you would have to separate the facts from the fiction or from the opinions that we make from the facts that are given. Like, of course, yes, so he was in a hurry to reach his home and he was really missing, you know, that British breakfast. So we can think that he was feeling very hungry, or he's been away for a long time. He's feeling very homesick, isn't it? These are the opinions that we make on the basis of it. Then we learn that when he is there, he's decided to fly, although it might not be a very long distance. But yes, there are certain rules that you need to follow. You're going to fly. What are things you need to make sure that everything is in order? Right? And one of them is, yeah, you must see that the fuel is there, right? The tanks are full. You're taking such a big risk. So when we have these information, I give you a statement here, right? So the things that happened when he saw the clouds and all of a sudden, you know, like all the, what are the needles and everything, the instruments creating a problem. And he was there very panicking and really wondering what to do, right? So when we, so what does it reflect on him as a pilot? Do we think of him as a responsible person on the basis of the facts that are given? What do we think about him? Then that means he was in such a hurry to fly back home that he did not take the required safety checks, right? So no matter how much in a hurry you are, and if you are there, you know, like you need to make sure that, yes, you will take your fuel tank, you'll take the air pressure, you will see that you're wearing the seat belt, you're following all that, right? So in your hurry or in your, you know, desire to reach home, you should not be that. So we have these facts and we can make our opinion about it. And once again, it is for you to decide. All the facts are given over here. What is this element in this story? Is it a supernatural element? Is it an hallucination? Is it an illusion? Right? Was it a figment of his imagination? Right? But then because, yes, we get a big reality check in the end of the story when the lady there tells him that there's no other plane on the radar. You're the only one flying tonight. The only one who are brave enough to take this flight and go through this bad weather. Okay? Right? Clear? Is this clear? So rest, of course, here. Once you have read all the things, all the details that you should be aware of. Next, it's about... What is the next one? Yes, that is where we get the name of the book. Right? So we have here... The first flight. Now, when you talk about first flight here, about the seagull, right? Sometimes, of course, it was there. You know, the seagull is pretending that I can't see anyone, so nobody can see me also. Isn't it? It's ignoring, right? Does not want to fly. Doesn't want to do, you know, like, does not want to take that risk, or it does not ready to... You know, like, be brave enough. Do you think this experience is relatable? Yes, can you relate it with the things that you do? Have you learned to walk and have you learned to drive and all, right? That initial fear is there. But once you take that first step and then there are no fears at all. Is it relatable? Can I say it is... something which many have experienced, yes or no, right? Yes. Then when I talk about, what about the behavior of the little seagull? What about the behavior of the family? What about the behavior of the seagull? Yes, right. So it pretended to be asleep. Right, and how he was trying to avoid, and he saw his brothers and sisters all flying around and they're cawing and they're so happy, and the parents are also so proud and look at them. But yes, as his parents never give up so easily, right? Even till they have not made the last effort, they will not give up. So, what did the mother seagull do? It was one whole day, it had been so. And yes, sitting on the edge of the cliff there, the little bird, very tired, very hot, and is hungry also. And you could see that his mother is there, having the piece of fish in her beak. And was it out of hunger? The little bird took that leap? Yes, right? And in that moment of hunger, forgot that I'm scared. I don't want to fly and I might fall into the vast green sea that is visible, right? So those are the fears in the little bird's mind, yes? But when the mother came with that piece of fish and immediately jumped towards it and was able to take his first flight. So what was there so beautiful about that flight? What was there? Can anybody tell me? Yes? Can anybody tell me? Yes, the seagull will be there near the sea because it is right birds which are found near the coastal areas. And how the bird there jumping towards that fish saw the mother's beak and immediately took that plunge. And first of all, yes, there is that moment of fear. And then afterwards, what happened? It just spread its wings and the wind also helping the bird to fly. And when the bird started flying, what did it realize? Who was there with him? His family, encouraging him, supporting him. And yes, so when initially he was, you know, like a couple of hours ago, he was so afraid of the sea, that it is so vast and it might be so deep and so scary. But then, of course, as he developed the confidence, as he developed the courage to fly, was it afraid of coming down? And how it came down and sat, you know, like, of course, skimming on the surface of the, and it actually the, what you can see, the claws going into the water, into the sea, right? So some things are there, you know, we see that things, they do come naturally. But yes, even if they do come to us naturally, we have to make an effort. So unless and until you don't make an effort to walk or run, to talk, right? So you're never going to learn. So here it is, yes, we have to overcome our hesitation, we have to overcome our fear, yes, our laziness also, right? So sometimes, yeah, you feel like, okay, I don't have to walk. So maybe when you were a kid and sometimes you would do that, okay, I'm feeling very tired, I don't want to walk, it's too far and this and that, and doing some kind of drama and all, and making your parents carry you, isn't it? But they don't carry you now, isn't it? They say you stay here only, don't go, right, if you don't want, have to. So they're not, you would be what, it's such a way to carry you all, isn't it? I think so. The biggest, it would be even waking you all up in the morning is such a big problem. That's a momentous task, big task, right? So, but you people are early risers because you have come to class. So hats off to you all, very good. Okay, so here, once again, yeah, we have facts. We are going to make our opinion. Now, if I say, let us just start here. Let us make a set of sequences. Can you tell me about which the black aeroplane? Isn't it? That is the first story? Okay, there are two stories. No, I can make the second first, first, second. Yeah, I have to do two stories. Now, when I start with, I am going to, you can end with a safe landing. Can I start off? Can you give me three steps which happened before it? Can you start? Can you tell me three things that happened before the safe landing? Okay, yes. So, what is it? So, the weather was okay, suitable for flying. All right. Okay, right. Let us, if I just have to do it in four steps, it's a safe landing, okay, or it takes the flights to London, okay, right. So what happens then in the middle of the right or just, yes. So the problem or what is there, the clouds, the dark clouds. Dark clouds, and there is a difficulty to, yeah, all that thing, right? Fine, I can. Then what happens? Yes, yeah, so a black mysterious. We don't know it is mysterious. We come to know later that it is mysterious. So we don't know it is mysterious. So we see the black aeroplane without any, yeah, nothing, nothing. So black aeroplane. And guiding to destination, isn't it? Or to safety, okay? So I can give you jumbled up sequences, right? I can, I will. And you have to arrange them in sequences. And remember here, like, of course, when you have to do this, when we write our concept maps also, when we make our flow charts also, so we have to remember that we have to write very short, brief points. Okay, so this is the sequence of events over here. What about the seagull? What about the seagull? Let us say, of course, he had a safe landing and here he lands on the sea, right? So how can I start that? Where do I start it from? What are the sequences here? Come on, you give it. We are coming to this. This is your end. Yes? What was the seagull doing? Yes, right? Afraid and pretending to be
coward.
Okay. Then, what were going to do? What was not motivating for him? Brothers and sisters flying? Yes, ignored by? Ignored by family? Then? Yes, of course, he was, his hunger drives him to fly, right? And of course, he wants to catch the fish, isn't it? From the mother's beak, okay? Right, and of course, after that, it's smooth sailing or smooth flying and many, many flights, but it was always the first flight that creates a bit of a problem, isn't it? Right, so it is there. So please make sure that you are aware of the sequence of steps. Then you should be aware of the word meanings also, which are there in context. The questions can be there. So it's going to be a mixed bunch of questions, right? So please hear, like, of course, these are the facts here, right? What are your opinion here? Why was he pretending to be asleep? This is a fact that we have. Why was he pretending to be asleep? This is our opinion. Because he was afraid of flying. Because he did not want to fly. Wanted to be left alone. Right? Yes. Then ignored by family. Okay. So why? So of course, maybe they tried the best. Yeah. So when you don't listen to your parents, eventually they give up. They say, okay, fine. Do whatever you want to. Isn't it? But if we give up on small ones, if we give up on young ones, then it is going to be a big loss for them, right? And that is when we have to teach them, okay? Right, yes, so hunger drives him to fly. So we have the facts here, right? And because of his hunger, he forgot his fear. And then, yes, so we have that. So he's landed on the sea, and that means he has overcome his fear, right? So he saw the sea from the distance, and he thought he might fall down. Even when flying also, that is what he was worried about, that his wings might not be so strong enough. So do you think here, you know, when we think about this little bird flying and we see the birds with huge wingspan, right? So you have those eagles and you have the albatross and you have, right, other birds there with huge wingspan and they fly. So what is it? Is it the wingspan that makes a difference? Then? Yes, speed, of course, here, the distance they can travel, those are things secondary here. But what is there? The basic desire to fly, isn't it? The courage that you have to muster, the courage that you have to develop to fly. Okay, right? Is it clear? Yes, a very simple story. I think it's such a sweet story, especially about the seagull. You know, now he pretends and all. You think about little children, you know, like, look at him behaving like that. Absolutely like a small pampered child, isn't it? So now all of you look at the screen here. Yes. So we are going to do a little bit about a subject verb agreement. Okay, so I've just been told that the time is going to be over, so we'll continue tomorrow.